going to be in Isaiah chapter 36, starting there and continuing our stroll through the book of Isaiah. And in chapter 36, we come to the conclusion of a real long narrative that's been going on of God, of Isaiah warning Judah about the coming threat of the kingdom of Assyria. And I don't know how many Sundays now we've considered that issue, that a great storm is coming and Judah needs to wake up to their faith. Today we have a wonderful and encouraging story of unshakable faith, rewarded in the face of unimaginable crisis. We have a battle of Satan's lie, with his lies thrown at us in times of crisis, and the power of God's promises that we can trust in him. But Satan's a liar, and he loves to twist the truth whenever he can, right? Former Secretary of State Henry Kissinger once told the New York Times, "Listen, there cannot be a crisis next week. My schedule's already full. Don't we wish we could schedule crises a little better?" But we can. Have you ever noticed they tend to pile up sometimes? Where you're just sort of thinking you're finishing with one, and here comes another. They come whether schedules permit or not. But how do we handle them? And I think I want to begin just with a thought here on this next slide. What life does to us depends on what life finds in us. A crisis doesn't make a person, it shows what a person is made of. Amen? I like that. What life does to us depends on what life finds in us. What a simple way of saying, who's in there? When the crisis comes, what's plan A? What's plan A for your life? Now today our topics, chapter 36 and 37 is pretty simple. Chapter 36 is Satan's lies attack God's people. And so he comes with this great leader of the Assyrians to try to scare the people. Next slide. Yeah. And then chapter 37, God's promise, his promise is to defend them. So we're going to get a good lesson in the ploys and strategies of Satan, and then we're going to get a great lesson in how do we stand up to those. What's our reaction? What's our response to the enemy when he comes? Now King Hezekiah is facing an enormous crisis in our passage this morning, and he gives us a great example of God-dependent faith through prayer. Let's just begin in verse 1 of chapter 36. In the 14th year of King Hezekiah, Sennacherib, king of Assyria, came up against all the 45 cities of Judah and took them. Now, Sennacherib later on would boast that he conquered 46 walled cities in Judah alone. Now, he's already completely conquered the northern kingdom of Israel. But in Judah, 46 cities. I'd say he's probably pretty confident when he gets to Jerusalem, eh? Verse 2, the king of Assyria sent the Rabshakeh. Now this is a title, the Rabshakeh. It's a title, sort of the field commander of the army. This would be Sennacherib's Patton, okay? General Patton, so to speak. I'm probably just going to end up calling him Rabshakeh because it's a hair faster, and I got to say his name a bunch this morning. But so we're going to read a lot, hear a lot from old Rabshakeh this morning. So he's speaking for the enemy. Now, what's cool, there's tons of archaeological proof of the accuracy of the Bible's history that we see this morning regarding this Assyrian invasion. The Assyrians themselves pretty much fully documented it in the excavations of Nineveh, the capital of Assyria, that they found all kinds of stuff, inscriptions written way back there, including references to the siege of Jerusalem. So this is flat out, this is what happens. The Bible's accurate. All archaeology has supported it. And so King Sennacherib is going to send a very large part of his army northward. He's actually gone, attacked from the north, and if you will, Mediterranean, Israel, okay? He's gone along to the coast and come along the coastal plains of Palestine because it's green, it's verdant. When you have an army the size of his, they need water. They need farmland to pillage and steal food from to feed their army. And the enemies would very often come along that side. They've actually gone south of Jerusalem. They're below. We're going to see they're in a city called Lachish, which was a walled city, which there's also a story of the conquering of Lachish by Sennacherib in the Assyrian historical records. And then they're going to send an army back up north, up the mountain to Jerusalem. So that's sort of what's happening. They've conquered the coastal area. Now they're coming back up from the south to get to Jerusalem. So this guy, this field commander, he's come up to the wall of Jerusalem, and he's not alone. I would just suggest, he comes with an army of 185,000. That's a bunch. I imagine they're in view in some way, shape, or form as we go along. So just sort of keep that. He's there, but he's not just there by himself. Now, I don't know if it's on the horizon. Have you ever seen these movies where these massive armies are just like these gray squares on the hills in the distance, but then you realize it's rank upon rank upon rank upon rank. I mean, something like that. I'm going to Jerusalem in November. I'll be able to preach better on this because I'll be able to stand on the wall and imagine what they're looking at. So I'm looking forward to that. But I imagine much, if not all, this army in view. Imagine, crazy. It says he stood by the conduit. That would be just a road of the upper pool on the highway to the washer's field. So he's just outside the wall, I believe, at the great gate into Jerusalem. Verse 3, and there came out to him Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah, who was over the household of Hezekiah, the king of Judah, right? And Shebna, the secretary, and Joah, the son of Asaph, the recorder. And so crises always do seem to come when things are at their best. Things are generally going pretty well. In history, Hezekiah has been a great king. He's 14 years into his reign. He's done great things. I could take you to 1 Kings or 2 Kings 18. We could read all about the amazing things Hezekiah had done for the Lord. He was a great king. It says he's the greatest king of Judah. All the kings before him, all the kings that would follow. He wasn't greater than King David. King David was king over all of Israel and united Israel, not this divided one. But Hezekiah was the greatest king of the southern kingdom of Judah. But then all of a sudden he's done all that. Now Assyria, he bribed Assyria not to attack Judah. We're going to touch on that. That was one of his shortcomings and trust, right? And so what's happened now? They've invaded and they're going like a hot knife through butter in Judah. And they're now at the gates of Jerusalem. So Hezekiah, put his trust in treaties and treasures. It says he stripped all the gold and silver out of the temple and out of the king's household and all that and took it to the king of Assyria. But you know what? King Sennacherib kept the wealth but did not keep his word. Have you ever tried to negotiate with Satan? Have you ever tried to negotiate with the enemy? He'll ask for everything, you give it, and then you still end up in a pit, in a hole. He also tried to negotiate with Egypt for help against Assyria. Again, small failures in his faith, but he's going to come through well for us this morning, right? They have to learn a lesson here that faith is living with God is plan A, not plan B or C. And he pays attention to which plan he is in our lives. And they haven't come, the Assyrians, they haven't come to negotiate, but to demand the surrender of Jerusalem. And the speech we're about to read is the field commander's speech. And it's considered the most insolent and blasphemous speech found anywhere in Scripture, for he insults the God of Israel personally. And I don't recommend that. But also, we should realize his speech is a masterful piece of psychological warfare in which he discredits everything that the Jews are holding dear to. As they're standing out, Jerusalem was a difficult city to conquer, man. It had great walls. Okay? But the Assyrians were convinced they were invincible, and that the God of Israel was no different than all the other gods they conquered in getting to Jerusalem. Okay? Now verses 4 to 6, Rabshakeh mocks Judah's trust in its alliance with Egypt. Verse 4, and Rabshakeh said to them, say to Hezekiah, thus says the king of Assyria, what do you rest this trust of yours? What are you resting your trust? Now, he's going to attack their trust 7 times in the next few verses, over and over again. He's going to question their trust. What are you trusting in? Then he tries to knock that leg out from under. Are you trusting in that? I'm going to knock that leg out from under you. Now, the things they're trusting in, though, are good things for the most part. Not all of them are bad. We'll see, especially when we get down to the trust in the Lord. But here's his point. He said, are you going to trust in Egypt? We're 46-0 against kings and rulers of other nations just in your country of Judah. Do you think you're going to stop us because you worship this God of yours? Anyway, verse 5. Do you think that mere words are strategy and powerful war? And whom do you now trust? And you've rebelled against me. Behold, you are trusting in Egypt, that broken reed of a staff, which will pierce the hand of any man who leans on it. Such is Pharaoh, king of Egypt, to all who trust in him. Now, he's saying that we're going to see at the very end of the day today, they end up being scared by Egypt. But right here, he's saying, you're trusting in this. It's like a walking stick that's so weak it shatters. And you ever broken? Like I had a shovel at home. It cracked. I didn't realize it. I slid my hand down and that sliver was up there. And anyway, you get the idea. He's saying, that's what he's like. It's like a walking stick that shatters and you put your weight on it and it drives right through your hand. Are you trusting in that? Anyway, your supposed ally Egypt's a little more than a flimsy walking stick. Good luck with that. Verse 7, he mocks Judah's trust in God. Now here's where he crosses the line. Verse 7, but if you say to me, we trust in the Lord our God, is it not he whose high places and altars Hezekiah has removed, saying to Judah and to Jerusalem, you shall worship before this altar? Now I'll tell you, Rabshakeh, being a polytheist, he shows his ignorance of the true understanding of the worship of Jehovah, because Jehovah had said, worship me only at my temple. And we need to understand in the days of the patriarchs, in Genesis, they would stop, and very often when God did a work, and they'd build an altar right there. Okay, so that worked okay for the patriarchs, okay? But now, this is in the promised land. When the Jews came into the promised land, build for me a house in Jerusalem, and there you shall worship me. That's what God said. Now Rabshakeh comes in. They don't know. All they know is that he's been tearing down the people had built altars to Jehovah up on high places. Why? Because they wanted to worship God their way. I'll worship God my way. I don't really care what the word says. So the little place of God, it's a long walk to Jerusalem. But you know what? It's a slippery slope when you start to do that. It's a very short distance from I'm going to worship God my way, to slightly changing how I look at God, to slightly changing how I serve Him, to slightly beginning to look at other gods that seem to be working in us. And pretty soon, these high places that were meant to be a good thing, that we know they turned into the altars of Molech and Baal and these pagan gods of the Canaanites. So there was a reason in that. But there's another interesting thing. I think he's doing a little twist. He's trying to see if he can get the people to realize. So Hezekiah went up and tore those down. So Hezekiah is telling you how to worship. Why are you following that? He's gone up and torn down all your altars. So it's just psychological warfare. He's trying to find any little wedge he can to create a discouragement in the Judean people, right? You know, God's word tells us, lean not on your own understanding, but on every word that proceeds from the mouth of God, right? But this man's ignorant of God's word. Hopefully the people of Judah are not. Verse 8 and 9, Rabshakeh mocks the army of Judah. He says, hey, come, make a little wager with my master, the king of Assyria. Here's what I'm going to do. I will give you 2,000 horses, 2,000 cavalry horses, okay? All you got to do is put soldiers on them. But here's the deal. He knows they haven't got 2,000 men. But he says, we're willing to fight you with one hand tied behind our back. We'll give you 2,000 horses, and if you can put men on them, fine. But then what does he go on and say? In verse 9, how then can you repulse a single captain among the least of my master's servants when you trust in Egypt for chariots and horsemen? And so he's saying, even if I did that, even if we said, it's like, have you ever played horse? You miss, you get a letter. He's basically telling them, listen, we're willing to start with HORS, and we're still going to beat you. Okay? Boom, you're shot. Okay? He's really trying to discourage them. Right? We don't care what you do. Even if you come up with 2,000 riders, we're going to still smoke you. Verse 10 goes on. Rabshakeh finally turns the truth on its head. And he tries to tell them now that the Lord God of Israel is actually on his side. Is that not devious? Look at verse 7. Moreover, is it without the Lord that I have come up against this land to destroy it? why the Lord said to me, go up against this land and destroy it. Dude is putting words in God's mouth. I highly don't recommend that, okay? Now, God did allow the Assyrians to come in and defeat Israel and to chasten the nation, but he had never intended for the Assyrians to conquer Judah and destroy it and tear down Jerusalem. They were supposed to just take care of Israel and give Judah a wake-up call, but they stepped over their bounds. Why? In prideful arrogance. And they just, why should we stop at the border? Let's keep going. And now, but now he's coming up and saying, hey, your God must be on my side. Look at all the cities we've destroyed in Judah now. Satan always does this. Hey, your God isn't fair. He's not on your side. He's not for you. He's obviously for the other side, whoever the other side is, but he's not for you. It's a common ploy of Satan. So now we have this big meeting going on. Can you imagine how curious now? Okay, so this guy shows up, and he's probably on some great white battle stallion. Can you imagine the people wanting to get up on the wall and watch what's going on? The people of Jerusalem? I think that's what we have happening. Look at verse 11. So he started this these attacks on Judah. Now these three men that Hezekiah sent out, it says in verse 11, then Eliakim, Shebna, and Joah said to Rabshakeh, please speak to your servants in Aramaic, for we understand it, but do not speak to us in the language of Judah within the people that are up on the wall. Okay, can you do us a favor? Are you kidding? They're negotiating with this guy? Like, he cares? He wants every person in Jerusalem to hear what he's saying, you know? Listen, Satan never wants a fair fight. He doesn't give a rip about your concerns, ever. Okay? Verse 12, but Rabshakeh said, hey, my master sent me to speak these words to your master and to you, and not, you really think, not to the men sitting on the wall who are doomed with you? This is just the Bible, people. I'm just reading the Bible. Doomed with you to eat their own dung and drink their own urine? Wow. I'm telling you right now, that's a diet you'll lose weight on. I guarantee it. Listen, all that is, that's a threat of coming siege. Everyone understood the terror of being in a siege, of being in a city surrounded with no food, no water, nothing coming in. That army just waiting you out, waiting you out. Cannibalism, you know, terrible things happening and just sort of going. That's what you're signing your people up for, you know. Now, Hezekiah had done something very cool. I can't spend all the time, but he had built a tunnel. There was a pool outside the wall that they dug a tunnel into the city of Jerusalem. It's like 1,700 feet long. You would walk down it today. It's called Hezekiah's Tunnel. And then they covered up the pool that was outside so no one knew it was there, but they had an inexhaustible supply of water within the city. Now, the Assyrians apparently don't know that. And with water, you can make anything stretch out a little longer, you know? The real problem with the siege, if you can get them without water, or wait till their water runs out. That's what a human body cannot deal with. Okay? All that to say, God had given Hezekiah the wisdom to do this beforehand. But here's the deal, too. You know, Satan can't starve us out because we have, Jesus said, we have a stream of living water in us. No matter what's happening in your life. The enemy can come around you and attack you and surround you, but he can't get to the source of your spiritual water of salvation, which is salvation in Jesus Christ. But, you know, that's what he told the woman at the well. Listen, you can drink this, you're going to get thirsty, but I have living water. She said, tell me about it. I want that living water. What a beautiful story that turns into. We got to move on. Verse 13, then the Rabshakeh stood and called out in a loud voice in the language of Judah, completely ignoring a request. Hear the words of the great king, the king of Assyria. Thus says the king, do not let Hezekiah deceive you, for he will not be able to deliver you. Now that's actually true. Hezekiah can't deliver them. God can deliver them. Okay? But what's he doing? Now we're going to see this word deliver. Before, he was talking about truth. He was attacking all their truths. You know, the truths you're depending. Now, he's going to attack God's ability to deliver them out of trial, right? So we're going to start seeing that word a lot, right? Verse 15. Do not let Hezekiah make you trust in the Lord by saying, the Lord will surely deliver us. This city will not be given into the hand of the king of Assyria. Do not listen to Hezekiah. And so we're going, here's a much better option. Don't trust your king or your God. Trust, you can trust me. You can trust us good old Assyrians. Oh, brother, if you knew what their reputation was in conquering lands, this guy is really self-deceived. But anybody's going to fall for this. He goes on in verse 16, for thus says the king of Assyria, make your peace with me and come out to me. Then each one of you will eat of his own vine and each one of his own fig tree. Each of you will drink the water of his own cistern. But with Satan, there's always a catch. Here it comes. There's always a catch. 17, you're going to do all of that and it's going to be milk and honey, right? Until I come and take you away to a land like your own land, a land of grain and wine, a land of bread and vineyards. And that's what Assyria always did. If they conquered a land, they depopulated it of the endemic people, took them to their land where they'd be lost and confused and not knowing how they're going to survive, and then they'd bring their own people back into the conquered land. No worry of rebellion, that sort of thing. He's just, man, if he was Pinocchio, every bit of that far. He's referring to their policy of ethnic cleansing and forced resettlement. You know, and they literally, when they marched you off, they would put rings, they would make these rings, they tie up your hand, they put rings through your nose and through your mouth, hooks, to the next person. Guess what? You're not going to tug too hard in that march. You're just going to go along. I mean, they knew how to do these things. It's terrible. I didn't show any pictures. I found a carving from Nineveh. It shows them flaying the skin off people they've conquered. And that's how horrible the Assyrians were. And that's just scratching the scratch of what they did. But here's this guy. Look at the picture he's painting. Be careful of the enemy. He always lies. He always lies. His ultimate purpose is to destroy us. What a great story we have here. Satan loves to dress up sin or any alternative to God's purpose is to look good and such. But it's all pure propaganda. You know, the Nazis used the exact same lies to get the Jews to peacefully get on the trains. I read a great fictional novel by Joel Rosenberg about Auschwitz. Very historically documented, but fictional characters, etc. But man, they were masters at convincing the Jews that they were being taken to resettlement areas and things like that. They went so far as to have people write letters from Auschwitz back to their family or friends. They said, what ghetto did you come out of? You know, okay, we're gonna. And these people would get letters, and they talk about being on the train, and people are saying, oh, it's going to be wonderful. Here, look at my letter from my sister at Auschwitz. And you know, but it's something, and it's like there's a scene where like five of them pull out their letters. And in every letter, the person that wrote it spoke of someone in their family as if they were alive that was dead. And so everyone would read their letter. Now it's kind of weird why he talks about his sister, like he can't wait to see her when he gets home. She died 5 years ago. And the next one, you know, he can't wait to go to you know, so-and-so's bar mitzvah. You know, when he turns 70, weird because he died at birth. And what they found, the people were sending back messages that the interpreters that would read the letters would have no way of knowing if this person was alive or dead. But they were trying to let people know, don't get on. Don't do it. Death is waiting here. Incredible. But it's very much what we see right here. You know, Satan has a very shallow bag of tricks. 2,700 years ago, he's doing this. And 70 years ago, he did it again in Germany. You know? So that's good for us if we know God's word. And we can be wise to the ploys of Satan. So Rabshakeh's been doing pretty good, but now he makes a fatal mistake. He flat out mocks God, making Jehovah to be nothing more than one of the many other pagan pantheon of little fake gods. Verse 18, beware lest Hezekiah mislead you by saying, the Lord will deliver us. Has any of the gods of the nations delivered his land out of the hand of the king of Assyria? Where are the gods of Hamath and Arpad? Where are the gods of Sarabim? Have they delivered Samaria out of my hand? Who among all the gods of these lands have delivered their lands out of my hand that the Lord should deliver Jerusalem out of my hand? Your God's no different. I've defeated them all and we're going to defeat yours. What? You just surrender. They don't want to have a big battle. They just want Jerusalem to surrender. You know, because they know it's going to be a long, drawn-out thing. and he's trying to destroy their trust in God. Have you not been attacked by arguments like this?
Mm-hmm.
Your faith?
Yeah.
From unbelievers or in difficult seasons or whatever it is? I mean, you'll either get it from someone else or that little voice in there going, you know, why are you trusting the Lord? Why are you doing that? I just remember, you know, when Opal was in the hospital with leukemia, you know, the enemy came to us and she was in her bed in there and it was screaming, look down this hall on this floor, I've killed everybody, why do you think you're going to live? That's what it was like, because you know what? We saw them leaving. It's a terrible disease, but you know what? We stood by the Lord. We refused to give up. And he says, I can't speak for them. I cannot speak for their faith. I can only speak for our faith. And the Lord's told us we're going to live and proclaim the glory of the Lord. And so we stood on that. But I'm telling you, it did not stop the attacks from coming. I'm sure some of you have experienced the same thing. Our God is not just another God, right? But this guy's really overstepped his bounds now, right? It reminds me of the way Goliath really spoke his own demise, didn't he? When he belittled God.
Yeah.
And what did God do? I was listening. He brings a little shepherd boy. He picks up a little stone out of a stream. And he is on his face in the dirt in no time. You know, don't mock God. And really, God has the Assyrians right where he wants them. Now they're overconfident. Interesting, we see the people's response. And it's, you know what? It's disciplined silence. Again, that's a good word for us this morning. Verse 21, but they were silent and answered him not a word, for the king's command was, do not answer him. I'm not positive if the they there is these three servants that Hezekiah sent out to talk with Rabshakeh, right? Or if they is all the people that were probably three people deep along the wall listening to, I don't know which, maybe both. But they don't answer. And that's good advice. Don't negotiate with the devil. I said it before, I'll say it again. Don't try to strike a deal with the world when it comes to your faith and the practice of it. Don't sink a compromise. Don't seek a compromise with the evil one, no matter how desperate the situation seems to be. And so they remain silent. Reminds me of the proverb that says, don't answer a fool according to his folly. If they knew anything about the Word of God, they knew this guy has no idea who Jehovah is. No clue. Now, there's no question this is a God-sized problem, but that's okay. That's okay. Verse 22, then Eliakim, the son of Hilkiah, who was over the household chief of the secretary, and Joah, the son of Asaph, the recorder, came to Hezekiah with their clothes torn, told him the words of Rabshakeh. So clearly these three guys returned to Hezekiah. And I'll tell you, they've been shaken. They've been that far away from this verbal onslaught. I'm telling you what, I've been around intensely unspiritual people, and sometimes you sort of feel like you're just getting, you know, because maybe you didn't know you were walking into that scenario, and you're sort of not exactly expecting it. And all of a sudden, it's just like you're getting blown by one great accusation against my faith. And I had a guy just the other 2 weeks ago, yeah, you know, nothing I have against you Christians is blah, blah. Like, by the way, we Christians just one giant amorphous blob are all identical. You know, every church is identical. So he can go, oh, you Christians, I know. Honestly, you know what he was saying? He was saying it was the church's fault, the massacre in Orlando. Now, is that Satan turning? Isn't that just like what we have here today? Taking the truth, turning it upside down to attack the Lord? Because of your attitude. I'm like, dude was a Muslim radical, man. I mean, he claimed allegiance to ISIS. It's the church's fault, you know? I mean, I just couldn't believe it. It was something, you know, oh, you know, all the stuff you know, you do against the homosexuals. Dude, I know what I was thinking. But you know what? As I recall, Europe's been very friendly in that regard. And number two, has welcomed in all of the Muslim refugees. And has done everything for the LGBT community. And they're getting hit 5 times harder than we are. How is it our fault that this happened? I mean, you're lying. I mean, Satan's logic, I mean, listen, it was just like, are you kidding me, really? Anyway, that was all for free. It was not in my notes when I got it. Chapter 37, gotta keep rolling. Gotta keep rolling. I just want to say now, right now, if you're going through a life crisis of some sort, your peace has been shaken by some sort of bad news, If you are beset by seemingly insurmountable circumstances, perhaps medically or financially or relationally, pay close attention to our boy Hezekiah here in the next few paragraphs. God wants to teach us something. It could be a word for a few people in here today to encourage you. Verse 1, as soon as Hezekiah heard, so these guys come, they had torn their clothes, classic Jewish response to great sorrow and worries, that tear their clothes and go before the Lord and throw dust on their head and such things we read elsewhere. But it says, Hezekiah, he tore his clothes and covered himself with sackcloth and went into the house of the Lord. Great first step in time of crisis. He goes into the house of the Lord, but more importantly, he goes before the Lord of the house. So I don't know, for you, it's to come to the church on a Sunday when the last place you feel like him is getting out of bed and coming to church, but come to the house of the Lord because it's where the Lord is, where he gathers, where two or more are gathered in my name. He's here. So kind of knows that. He went to the house of the Lord. And he did it in all humility. You know, he's in sackcloth. He's covered himself. Not coming there in his pomp and his and all his glory and his robes and his crown. If he had the, he just goes, oh man, I just remember what Jesus said in the Beatitudes, blessed are the poor in spirit. God blesses the humble when they come before him and say, I got nothing for this. I depend on you to get us out of this, okay? I think he's been humbled by a circumstance. Hey, he's king of exactly one city now. Okay, how proud can you go before the Lord? He's allowed this to happen. He tried to buy off the Assyrians. That was a bust. Tried to get the Egyptians to defend them. That's been a bust so far. But he does go to the Lord now. And I think in great humility, confessing his failures and shortcomings and praying for salvation from God. I need you to act, Lord, right now. Right now. So verse 2. And he sent Eliakim, who was over the household, and Shebna, the secretary, and the senior priest, covered with sackcloth, to the prophet Isaiah. So he goes to the house of the Lord, and he sends his guys, go talk to Isaiah, and tell him this. And it says in verse 3, thus says Hezekiah, this day is a day of distress, of rebuke, of disgrace. And then it says, his children have come to the point of birth, and there is no strength to bring them forth. I think this is more of a colloquialism, a phrase that pictures a hopeless situation. You do understand that a baby cannot birth itself. And it's sort of like a circumstance of a mother says she doesn't have the energy. I don't know. You know, imagine a mother that's in a comatose state. I don't know. And before there's drugs for inducing labor. But it's sort of the point of, if the mother doesn't birth the baby, it doesn't get birth in time. And it's just a picture that says, listen, we are like that. Here we are, Jerusalem. We are like a pregnant woman, and we have no power to birth this child. We need you to breathe life back into this situation, right? Goes on in verse 4. Maybe that the Lord your God will hear the words of Rabshakeh, whom his master, the king of Assyria, sent to mock the living God, and will rebuke the words that the Lord your God has heard. Therefore, lift up your prayer for the remnant that's left. Great second step. What does he do? He goes to a spiritual mentor. He says, you know what, I'm going to go to the Lord, but you know what, I'm also going to go to someone that's shown me, they hear from the Lord. They know God's word. How many of you guys have anything to tell me? How many of you have been blessed by going to someone with a burden, and they just share a scripture that you needed to hear that day? How often does that happen? Or you get a devo on your morning email, and you go, wow, perfect. Or someone will come to me for counseling, and also the next morning I'll get one, and go, wow, that's for her, boom. Thank you. That's just what I needed. Thank you for praying for me. You know, but the great second step, find a spiritual mentor for encouragement and ask them to pray for you. So he's gone to that Lord of the house, and then he's seek godly counsel and encouragement to get. He needs wisdom right now, right? James 1:5 says, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives all to all without reproach. You ask the Lord for wisdom, he'll get it to you one way or the other. James 5 would tell us, just as the fervent prayers of a righteous man availeth much. Pray, and seek the body of Christ. That's the beauty of a church. The opportunity to create relationships here and find people that can minister to you. You can go to and trust them with what you're going through. Verse 5. Now here's a cool stuff. So they get to there. So the servants, king has a hi, came to Isaiah. Isaiah said to them, say to your master, thus says the Lord. Now, how's that for fast prayer answer? You know, go ahead and ask. I mean, it's like they walk in the door. Here's the answer to Hezekiah's prayer. Oh, okay. All I want to say, though, that in the building up of our faith, the Word of God and prayer go together beautifully, don't they? Romans 10:17 says, so faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the Word of Christ. So Isaiah knows that the king needs to hear a word from the Lord. And he's going to hear a word that does three things. First of all, God's going to say, don't be afraid. Then he's going to say, listen, the Assyrians are going to be leaving. And thirdly, this great king that's talking so big is going to die in his own city. Okay, so verse 6 goes on. This says the Lord, number one, do not be afraid because of the words that you have heard with which the young men of the king of Assyria reviled you. You know, there's almost 400 times in Scripture God's people are told, don't be afraid. Fear not. Usually the very first thing in a crisis, they go to the Lord, or an angel has been sent by the Lord to minister, and the very first words out of their mouth, fear not. Don't be afraid. Be anxious for nothing, but trust in me. What a good word, right? I love how God, that's his first word for us. Priceless words. Don't be afraid. Jesus said in John 16:33, I have said these things to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I've overcome the world. And you know what? We will overcome our tribulations in Christ. He will be faithful to get us through the storm. So many promises. I could refer to just about fear. Romans 8, you have not received the spirit that makes you a slave again to fear. In Christ, we're not to be a fearful people. 2 Timothy 1, we would find God did not give us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power, of love, and self-discipline. You know, in some ways we have to learn to stop being afraid. First thing, first go to the Lord. Deuteronomy 31, God has said, I'll never leave you, never will I forsake you. Those are God's words. So when someone like Rabshakeh comes into your life and starts saying, God didn't say that, doesn't do that, doesn't promise that, sorry. Yeah, he does. Yeah, he did. It's right here. Okay. I love this. I think G. Gordon Campbell was in a street of Chicago one day, and he had a woman run up to him and say, Pastor, I just want to tell you, I just found the greatest scripture about fear. It says, when I am afraid, I will put my trust in you. And he said, you know, I love that. That's a good one. But you know what? The Lord showed me a better one. And he recited Isaiah 12, he said, behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. A better starting point. The Lord's our salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. God reveals his plan to Hezekiah, verse 7. Behold, I'm going to put a spirit in him, the king of Syria, so that he shall hear a rumor and return to his own land, and I will make him fall by the sword of his own land. Just sort of saying, listen, Hezekiah, this is my problem now. You've given it to me. I can take care of it with my feet up. So relax. Here's what's going to happen. Okay? And that's basically what's going down. Verse 8, Rabshakeh returned. So he leaves Jerusalem and goes back down to where the king is fighting against Lachish, something like that. Actually, he moved now to Libna. It was a city nearby where he had heard that the king had left Lachish. Anyway, Rabshakeh goes and finds the king. Now, the king heard divine rumor concerning Tirzah, the king of Cush, Ethiopia. What did God just say up there in that earlier verse? He's going to hear a rumor, right? That's what I'm going to do? Yeah, I love that. I love that. I'm going to put a spirit in him so he shall hear a rumor. Wow, here it's happening. Okay, so the king hears that the Egyptian army, now Cush is actually Ethiopia. At this time, there was an Ethiopian, was the pharaoh. In Egypt, Egypt was very weak at this point in history now. They were no longer all that feared, but they could still put a lot of soldiers out in the field, right? But the bottom line is the king hears that there's now an attack from the south. He's sieging Lachish, and now, you know, Rabshakeh comes back to him with the news that they're not going to surrender. So here's the deal. The king's now worried. Okay, he sort of shoots another threat message to Jerusalem. And so we see that this king's real God is its self-pride, because he doesn't go to the house of his God. He doesn't pray to his God. He doesn't find his Isaiah of Assyrian belief. He just says, go back and intimidate him more. Look at verse 10. Thus you shall speak to Hezekiah, the king of Judah. Don't let your God in whom you trust deceive you by promising that Jerusalem will not be given into the hands of the king of Assyria. Frankly, at this point, I see his conviction wavering. I'm going to just trade the same old argument. Don't trust in the Lord. Surrender. But I don't think he believes it all the same. You know, verse 11, behold, you've heard what the kings of Syria have done to all the lands, devoting them to destruction. Shall you be delivered? Same arguments, right? The gods of the nations delivered them. The nations of my father destroyed. Gozan, Haran, Resep, the people of Eden who are in Telsar. Where's the king of Hamath, the king of our father? He's just naming off all these kings, right? Same old threat, old logic. Satan's not creative. He'll just keep using the same lies over and over again until we get wise and we learn. For some reason, I had this vision of a Wizard of Oz. Maybe this will help you. But as far as the king sort of beginning to doubt. Now, remember the scene, I don't know, most of you probably know. Remember, there's a scene where the Wizard of Oz gets exposed behind the curtain. He's coming here. He's going, and ignore the man behind the curtain moving all the levers. He just doesn't give up with the same lame story, you know? And the way King has this king, Sennacherib, is the same thing. You know, he actually is beginning to realize, I don't think I can conquer Jerusalem, but you should surrender anyway. You know, he's still moving the levers, just do it. And of course, it's not going to happen. But Hezekiah gets the letter that has this threat again. And here's what's cool, verse 14, epic. Goes, and Hezekiah went up to the house of the Lord and spread it before the Lord. I love that picture. If you don't remember anything else this morning, try to leave with that picture of what's in your life. Because there's just going to be days you just got to take it and you just got to spread it before the Lord and go, this is for you. This is for you. I can't do anything with it. I love the simplicity and the beautiful dependency on God there. Peter taught us in 1 Peter 5, 6, that humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him, because he cares for you. And that's what this is. Hezekiah's just casting his anxieties, laying at the foot of the Lord. In a way, he's going, Lord, I think I just got a letter, and it's addressed to you. I just thought I'd bring it to you. Okay? This one's for you. It was misaddressed to me. I can't deal with it. What a word for us. Just lay it before the Lord. And Hezekiah prayed to the Lord. Okay? And we're going to see here, he first speaks to the greatness and glory of his God. He just worships and adores God. He says, O Lord of hosts, heaven, God of Israel, enthroned above the cherubim. That's a reference to the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant had two cherubim over it, and that's at this time in the Holy of Holies, that's where God sat. It was above those two cherubim. Right? You are the God, you alone, of all the kingdoms of the earth. You have made heaven and earth. You know? And so he just gives glory to God. I think he's saying, sort of like this, I'm not getting off my knees, Lord, until I see you, God, as so much greater than my troubles. I'm going to pray here and just remember how great you are, and then look at my problems in comparison to that. You know what? And that's sort of what's happening. It's, again, a good word for us. Verse 17, incline your ear, O Lord, and hear, open your eyes, O Lord, and see, hear all the words of Sennacherib that he has sent to mock the living God. You know, truly, O Lord, the kings of Assyria have laid waste all the nations, I can't deny that, Lord, and have cast their gods into the fire, for they were no gods but the work of men's hands, wood and stone, before they were destroyed. But now he tells God what he needs. So he says, so now, O Lord our God, save us from this, from his hand, that all the kingdoms of the earth may know that you alone are the Lord. So Lord God, act on your behalf, that you'll be glorified. He's sort of saying like, listen Lord, here's the deal. If they come and overwhelm us, the greatest slaughter is not going to be all of us. The greater slaughter will be your glory, your glorious Lord. Instead, come and do a miracle, Lord, that your name will be lifted up all the peoples. With that. Bring glory to your name, Lord. That's a legitimate prayer. Bring glory to your name, Lord. 21. Then Isaiah the son of Amoz sent to Hezekiah, saying, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel. Because, so this is God answering Hezekiah's prayer, because you have prayed to me, a good word, because you have prayed to me concerning Sennacherib, the king of Assyria, this is the word that the Lord has spoken concerning him. This is as if this is now addressed to Sennacherib, the king. She despises you. She scorns you, the virgin daughter of Zion. She wags her head behind you, the daughter of Jerusalem. In other words, Jerusalem is often called the daughter of Jerusalem. The daughters of Jerusalem are the people of Judah in the Old Testament. It's basically saying, here's this virgin daughter just making fun of you from within the city of Jerusalem. Okay, so God's saying, you know, my people mock you now. You know, and he goes on and says, whom have you mocked and reviled? Against whom have you raised your voice and lifted your eyes to the heights? Against the Holy One of Israel. Big sin. To vile, the Holy One of Israel. And God's sort of saying, you want to fight with me? Well, you've got it. Okay? He goes on in verse 24, but your servants have mocked the Lord, and you have said with many chariots, I have gone up to the heights of the mountains, to the far recesses of Lebanon, to cut down his tallest. He's just talking about the bragging that the king of Assyria had done, that I've done all these things, right? But you know what? Sennacherib has an eye problem. He thinks he had done it all, when in fact God had merely permitted it to a point. But now you've mocked me. Verse 26, have you not heard that I determined it long ago? I planned from days of old, but now I bring to pass that you should make fortified cities crash into heaps of ruins, while their inhabitants, shorn of strength, are dismayed, confounded, and become like plants of the field. Okay? Verse 28, I know you're sitting down, and you're going out and coming in, and you're raging against me. Well, I want to say there in verse 28, God's saying, I've heard what you said about me, and I know where you live. Okay? Because we're like, I would be careful when you hear that. I've heard what you've called me, and dude, I know where you live, and I know when you're in, coming in and going out. Okay? Verse 29, because you've raged against me, and your complacency has come to my ears, I will put my hook in your nose and my bit in your mouth. How interesting. That's what I said they did. And God's saying, this is going to happen to you. This is what's coming. Okay? I'll turn you back on the way by which you came. By the way, I just want to tell you, God is not here responding to unfolding events. Okay, he's unfolding his response, which he had determined long before. There are no surprises happening in these two chapters to God. You know, so God doesn't react. He's not reactionary. He rolls out his plan that he's already had, right, for any circumstance. And now he speaks to Hezekiah and his people. He says, this shall be the sign for you this year. You will eat what grows of itself, and in the second year, what springs from that. And then in the third year, sow and reap and plant vineyards, and eat their fruit, and the surviving remnant of the house of Judah shall again take root downward and bear fruit upwards. Wow. And so it just reminded me of Psalm 1, verse 3. Now, how does God describe his faith? Well, he said, he is like a tree planted by streams of water that yield its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. And all that he does, he prospers. God's saying, listen, in 3 years, this is all going to be over with. And listen, this is going to be over with right now, but for the next year, you're going to have to scavenge a little bit. There's been a giant army, but there's going to be enough food to feed my people. In the second year, it's going to be a little bit better. Third year, start planting again, and I'm taking care of it all. I love that. You're going to help live this trial. You know, and we're going to outlive all our trials. We're even going to outlive our date with dying, by the way. We're going to way outlive that. That's what I like to remember. The cross has the last word on death, does it not? Verse 32, almost done. For out of Jerusalem shall go a remnant, out of Mount Zion, a band of survivors. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. Therefore, says the Lord concerning the king of Assyria, he shall not come into this city or shoot an arrow there or come before it with a shield or cast up a siege mound against it. And so they're expecting the worst. And God's saying, there's not even one lousy arrow is going to come and land inside the walls. Nothing. Nothing's happening, right? 34, by the way that he came, by the same he shall return, and he shall not come into this city, declares the Lord, for I will defend this city to save it for my own sake and for the sake of my servant David. I just going to remind you of what Jesus said about the church, right? The gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So today, the same promise from the Lord. Amen. Let me read this. Amazing. The angel of the Lord. Now notice it says the angel of the Lord. A lot of pastors preach this differently. I'm just going to share you my belief. I believe this is the pre-incarnate Christ. When you see the direct article, the angel of the Lord, I can't build it for you. You go out throughout Scripture every time we see this. This, the angel, says things only God can say. There's one place it says the angel of the Lord has the power to forgive sins. That's no angel. Okay, I'm just saying. Just saying. You don't have to believe me. It's not a salvational thing. Just my study of God's word has led me to that belief. When I see that, it says the angel of the Lord went out and struck down 185,000 in the camp of the Assyrians that night. And when people arose early in the morning, behold, there were all dead bodies. Is that not also bigger? Go to chapter 19 of Revelation. That sure reminds me of the Battle of Armageddon. It's one sentence long. Jesus shows up, battle over. All the enemies of God across the earth dead at one moment. Okay? That's why I think this is a picture of the coming Messiah. Okay? Right here in the Old Testament. And this idea, you know, how does he do that? I think God breathes life into us when we're born. frankly, he can breathe right back out of us. And just like you're one of these robots or something, when they turn off the power, you just crumple on the ground, you know? I don't think Jesus has to go through and have a gigantic sword fight with every bad guy on earth. No, I just think you know when you die, you exhale? I talked to some nurses that do hospice stuff, and don't tell me when you die and exhale, breath of life. And I just think that's God. Christ at any moment says he holds the world, he can put it in his way. At any moment, you just draw that life from these battles are nothing to him. It says, then Sennacherib, king of Assyria, departed, tail between his legs, and returned home and lived at Nineveh. It's interesting. Here's what Sennacherib wrote on some of these stelas, which are what they call places where they carve things. And Nineveh says, I made Hezekiah a prisoner in Jerusalem, his royal residence, like a bird in a cage. That's called utter denial. Okay. Now, for a day or two, it was actually true. But here's the deal. He neglects to mention they never conquered Jerusalem. And in their whole list of cities are conquered, he just said, well, I walked Hezekiah bloody bird in a cage. And that's all he did, man. And then he ran home. 38, as he was worshiping in the house of Nezroch, his god, the Dremelech, and Sherezer, his son, struck him down with a sword. Okay? And after they escaped into the land of Ararat, which is, I believe, Armenia today, Esherah, his son, reigned in his place. Don't miss the irony here. Hezekiah went to the house of his god and was saved. Sennacherib goes to the house of his god back in Nineveh, and his life is taken from him. You know, there's great irony in that, right? He gets assassinated, so God's prophecy of his death is fulfilled. Okay, some years later, but he also never came back into the land of Judah, the little old Judah. Assyria left and stayed gone. Amen. Okay, Ben, if you're going to come up and finish us with a closing, you know, closing thoughts on that. Story of two kings, two gods, and two faiths, isn't it? Hezekiah, against all odds, calls out to his god. Sennacherib, with seeming all the cards stacked in his favor, leaves Judah defeated, basically empty-handed, and he will be slain in short order. It's the story of a man who seeked out God by going to the house of the Lord. He prayed desperately to this all-powerful God. And he was not too proud to go to another believer and faithfully ask him to pray and give him encouragement. I sort of began with this thought this morning. What life does to us depends on what life finds in us. A crisis doesn't not make a person. It shows what a person is made of. We got to see what Hezekiah was made of because we got to see what was inside. He was a man that loved the Lord himself. And when all the cards are stacked against him, he says, if it's me and God, I'm in the majority. Okay? I don't care who's lined up against me. Amen? Amen. The only takeaway is real fast. Satan's lies always attack God's words. Did God really say that? Starts at the Garden of Eden, right? God really say? Loves to attack the Word of God. And finally, chapter 37, we see that when crisis comes, go to the Lord and lay it before him. And we trust in the Lord. He'll deliver us from our trials. Amen? Something in there for everyone this morning. Let's pray. Lord,